Bismillah, Assalamualaikum. Okay, so today we'll be talking about humans coordination and response. You guys ready? Good. Here we go.
Okay, so the first term that you will encounter in chapter 12 is sensitivity. So sensitivity is an organism's ability to detect changes in their environment. These changes we also know as stimulus. Now, we have learned about stimulus in the past, but in this chapter, we are going to learn about two different types of stimulus. One is external stimulus. The external stimulus we are familiar with, that is smell, touch, taste, etc., etc. Basically, anything that changes in our environment outside of the body. But the internal stimulus are the changes that occur inside of our body, such as blood osmotic pressure, body temperature, blood sugar level, and so on. So these things happen in our body and thus are classified as internal stimulus. Moving on. So as mammals, we can detect stimuli via our receptors. So let's say your phone is ringing, right? So when your phone is ringing, your receptor, or in this situation, your ear, will detect the sound of your phone and transform those sounds into a nerve impulse. So this nerve impulse will then be sent to the integration center through your neurons. Okay, so then at the integration center, that is your brain, those nerve impulse will be integrated and your brain will cause your effector to respond towards that stimulus. So let's say in this situation, your effector is your hand and your response is to pick up the phone. So these are the basic process or the simplest form of process of coordination. So coordination is a stimuli detection process by receptors, and it will always end with appropriate responses by the effectors, such as the example that I've shown you just now. So coordination ensures that your overall activities and systems of an organ function properly, and it also ensures that all systems and activities are synchronized perfectly at a complete unit. Ignore this one. So why synchronizing it perfectly is very important, because there are situations that requires more than one receptor. For example, your phone is ringing in your bedroom, but you're here in the living room. So when you hear your phone ringing, you will walk towards the bedroom, and that's already using one effector, that is your leg. And then when you arrive at the bedroom, you will look around to find your phone, which you're using the effector, effector, your eye. And when you found the phone, you will finally use your hand to pick up the phone. So your effector here is hand and your response is picking up the phone. So this shows that there are situations that requires you to use more than one receptor. Thus, synchronizing them perfectly will allow an appropriate and a fluid response.
Receptor. Sensory receptor found at the end of nerve fiber that detect information in the external and internal environment. The location of receptor will depend on a type of stimulus detected. Each type of receptor are usually sensitive to a specific stimulus. For example, the sensory receptor that detect external stimuli are found in special sensory organs such as eyes, tongues, nose, and skin. For internal stimuli, they are found in a specific internal organ like pancreatic cell that detect our blood sugar level. Now, we learn about necessity of response. Why do organisms have to respond to their stimuli and internal stimuli? The ability of organism to respond to their external environment is very important for their survival of organism. For some animals, in a sudden change of climate condition motivate them to look for a new shelter. The ability of organism to detect their change in internal environment also crucial, so the information will be transmitted to the integration center. The integration center will transmit this information to the effector to respond to the change. For some example, like our body, when our body temperature increases above the normal range, this information will transmit to the integration center, and then the integration center will send a nerve impulse to the effector to decrease the temperature and back to a normal range. In conclusion, human and animal need to respond to adopt.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. So today I will present about our nervous system, which is central nervous system. Second is peripheral nervous system. Our central nervous system consists of brain and our spinal cord. Our peripheral nervous system consists of our cranial nerves and peripheral nerves. Then move on to our brain. Okay. So basically, this is a diagram of our brain. So basically, in the front part, we have cerebellum, and then we have cerebellum, we have spinal cord, we have medulla oblongata, we have pituitary gland, and we have hypothalamus. So, firstly, the function of cerebrum is to control our emotion, hearing, sight, personality, and control action. So, the process is, cerebrum will receive information and stimulus from the receptor, and then it will analyze, integrate, and correlate to produce sensory perception, and then the response is determined and instructions are given to the effectors for our reaction. And lastly, cerebrum is also responsible for higher mental abilities such as learning, memorizing, linguistic skills, and mathematics skill. So, done for the cerebrum. And then, next is cerebrum. Cerebrums basically will maintain our body balance and coordination of muscle contraction for body movement. So all of our body movement, our body movement is being controlled by cerebellum. And next we have our medulla oblongata will basically controls our involuntary action, which is the action that we ourselves cannot control it, such as heartbeat, breathing, and food digestion. And then we have pituitary gland. Pituitary gland is the main gland of endocrine system, which means pituitary gland is the center of all of the endocrine gland. And this pituitary gland will control all of the hormone that is being secreted from the other endocrine system gland. And lastly, we have our hypothalamus. So, hypothalamus will basically control center that regulates our body temperature, water balance, blood pressure, and sense hunger, thirst, and fatigue of ourselves. And also, hypothalamus connect with our nervous system to the endocrine system through the pituitary gland, which means hypothalamus and pituitary gland is in one process to control the hormone that is being secreted. And lastly, hypothalamus is also responsible in controlling few types of pituitary gland's hormone. So that is basically for one part of our nervous system part, which is our brain. So, I hope you enjoy this presentation, and bye. Stay safe, guys.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. So, today I'm going to present about the spinal cord. So, spinal cord is contained within the vertebral column and is surrounded by cerebrospinal fluid that protects and supplies the spinal cord with nutrients. So, it is made up of white matter and then grey matter, grey, kelabu. Okay. So, the function of spinal cord is control reflex action, connect the brain with the peripheral nervous system, and process a few types of sensory information. So, the structure of spinal cord has four parts, which is spinal nerve, ventral root, dorsal root, and then dorsal root ganglion. So, we move to the peripheral nervous system. So, it consists of somatic nervous system and then autonomic nervous system. So, the somatic nervous system regulates all the controller actions. And then the autonomic nervous system, it controls involuntary actions such as our heartbeat and then our blood vessel. So, next we move to the neurons and synapse. So, what is the structure of neuron and synapse? It has six parts, which is axon, myelin shell, synaptic knob, dendrite, cell body, and then none of Ranvier. So, what is axon? Axon is an elongated branch of the body cells, and then axons carry impulses out of the body cells to other neurons, other neurons of effectors. And then myelin shell. Myelin shell has three functions, which is protects neuron from injury, function as an insulator for electrical impulses, and provides nutrients to the axon. So what is synaptic knob? Synaptic knob is a swelling at the end of the axon branch. So we move to dendrite. Dendrite are short branches of the cell body. So dendrite receive nerve impulses from other neurons of the external environment and sends them into the cell body. So cell body consists of a nucleus and many cytoplasmic projections called dendrites. So last but not least, not of Ranvier. So certain neurons have parts that are not insulated by the myelin shell at regular gaps along the axon. So the gap is known as not of Ranvier. So that's all for me.
About the types of neurons and its function, and then a little bit information about synapse. Check it out.
Here are the three types of neurons. So we start first with the sensory neuron. Sensory neuron is attached to the sensory organ. So its function is to receive impulse from the receptor in the sensory organ that is stimulated by in or out of the surrounding around us. Then it will send the impulse. Actually, the impulse, it always acts on cold and pain. Then it will send the impulse straight to the relay neuron. So next, we are moving on to the motor neuron. Motor neuron attached to the effector like muscle or gland. It will send impulse from the nervous system to center of effect to actually get an answer or the action that we shoot from the impulse of receptor that we get. And lastly is the relay neuron. Relay neuron is situated in the center of the nervous system. It attaches the sensory neuron and the motor neuron. It will then send impulse between these two neurons. So basically, the flows of the neuron started with the sensory neuron. It was started from the impulse from the receptor that the sensory neuron get, then it will send to the relay neuron, then the relay neuron will send it to the motor neuron to actually respond towards the impulse of the receptor. So as you can see at the image of the three neurons, actually there is synaptic knob and the dendrite, but what you can see is there is a gap in the between the dendrite and the synaptic knob that called synapse. So synapse is a pathway that the electrical impulses need to go through before it goes through all the neuron.
Explanation on how nerve impulses are transmitted across the synapse. It happens with three simple steps. Firstly, when an electrical impulse reaches a synaptic knob, this diagram, the synaptic vesicle is triggered into secreting neurotransmitters into the synapse. Then the neurotransmitters are diffused across the synapse. These red dots are known as neurotransmitters, and then bind to a specific receptor proteins on the dendrite of the receiving neuron. And then the binding of the neurotransmitters to the receptors stimulates the initiation of the next nerve impulse so that the impulse can be transmitted directly through this. I hope you